Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. This is the seventh video in the STM32 timer series, and today we will continue with another application of the timer synchronization. We will see how to cascade the timers in series, and by doing this we can combine three 16-bit timers into a 48-bit timer. Basically in cascade, the frequency of one timer will be used as the clock for another timer. This can be achieved by using the update event as the master timer output signal, along with external clock mode for the slave timer. The video was going to be very long, so I have decided to split them into two parts. This video will basically cover the slave timer in the external clock mode, also we will see the reset mode towards the end of the video. And in the next video, we will make a 48-bit counter using three timers, and we will also see its application. So let's start the Cube IDE, and create a new project. I am using the STM32F446RE. Give some name to the project and click Finish. First of all, I am selecting the external crystal to provide the clock to the MCU. The board has 8 MHz crystal, and I want to run the controller at 90 MHz. I am choosing 90 MHz because I want all the timers to have the same clock speed, and a PB2 timer clock can run at a maximum of 90 MHz. The clock setup is done, so let's start setting the timers now. Timer 1 is going to be the master timer. Here I am enabling the PWM on channel 1, so that we can see the output of timer 1. Right now the timer clock is at 90 MHz, so the prescaler of 90 would bring the clock down to 1 MHz. The auto reload of 100 would further reduce the timer frequency to 10 kHz. The trigger event should be selected as the update event. Basically, when the counter will reach the auto reload value of 100, this update event will get triggered. And if we use the update event in combination with the external clock mode, or gated mode, the output frequency of this timer can be used as the clock for the slave timer. Since the auto reload is 100, if I keep the pulse at 40, there will be the PWM signal with 40% duty cycle. Let's quickly see what we have configured so far. The timer 1 output frequency will be a PB timer clock, divided by the prescaler times the auto reload value, and this will be equal to 10 kHz. Now we will configure the timer 2. Let's see the internal trigger connection diagram. You can find it in the reference manual of your controller. Here you can see the timer 2 can be a slave to timer 1, and it will be triggered by the ITR0. Similarly, the timer 3 can be triggered by the timer 2, via the ITR1 signal. Let's configure the timer 2 now. The slave mode will be the external clock mode, and the trigger source will be ITR0. I am selecting the PWM on channel 1, so that we can see the output of this timer. Now, as I mentioned, when the update event is used with a combination of the external clock mode, the timer 1's output frequency will act as the input clock for the timer 2. Timer 2's frequency will be equal to input clock divided by the prescaler times the auto reload. The timer 1 frequency is 10 kHz, and if we use the prescaler 1 and auto reload of 100, the timer 2's frequency will be 100 Hz. So let's configure the prescaler as 1, and the auto reload as 100. I am keeping the pulse at 40, so the PWM duty cycle will be 40%. This timer 2 is a slave to timer 1, and master to timer 3. So we also need to enable the trigger event selection as the update event. Now the timer 3 will also have the similar configuration, except that the trigger source is from timer 2, so ITR1. Timer 3 frequency will be calculated in the similar manner, and if I use the auto reload of 10, the frequency will be 10 Hz. Now since the auto reload is set to 10, I am keeping the pulse at 4, so that we could get the duty cycle of 40%. Now all three timers are set, with timer 1 running at 10 kHz, timer 2 at 100 Hz, and timer 3 at 10 Hz. Click Save to generate the code. There is not much to do in the programming part, we will just start the PWM for all three timers. Alright, let's build and flash the code to the board. I have connected the PWM pins to the logic analyzer. Here we are getting the output from each timer. Let's analyze it now. Here you can see the timer 1 with 10 kHz frequency and 40% duty cycle. The timer 2 is running at 100 Hz with 40% duty. And timer 3 is at 10 Hz with 40% duty. This is as per the calculations we did earlier. So we saw how the frequency of one timer can be used as the clock for the second timer. Using this, we will cascade three timers and make a 48-bit counter, so that we can read a wide range of frequencies. This will be covered in the next video. Let's take a look at the reset mode now. Here I have already configured the timers. I have disabled timer 1, and timer 2 is now in the master mode with PWM enabled on channel 1. It is being clocked by the APB clock, so the base frequency is at 90 MHz. The auto reload value of 10,000 will reduce the clock to 9 kHz. Also, I am keeping the duty at 40, so with the auto reload value being 10,000, this is equivalent to 0.4%. Here is the calculation for the timer 2 output frequency. Also, the trigger event is set to update event. Now the timer 3 is the slave to timer 2, and is being used in the reset mode. In reset mode, whenever the update event is triggered, it will reset the counter of the slave timer. The trigger signal is coming from timer 2, so it is set to ITR1. As I mentioned, when the update event is used with the reset mode, or trigger mode, all the timers will be clocked by the APB clock, unlike the previous case, where the frequency of the master timer served as the clock for the slave timer. Here I have set the auto reload of 1234. The timer clock was 90 MHz, and now it is around 73 kHz. The pulse is set to 300, which is approximately 24% of the auto reload value. This is it for the setup, click Save to generate the code. The code will remain the same, just comment out the timer 1, as it is not being used. Let's build and flash the code. Here we are getting the PWM output for both the timers. You can see the timer 2 has the frequency of 9 kHz, and duty is around 0.4%. Timer 3 has the frequency of around 73 kHz with the duty around 24%. Let's zoom in to understand what's happening. If you check the width of the timer 3 signal, it is around 3 or 3.5 microseconds. The data is a little bit inconsistent because I can't use higher sampling rate with this logic analyzer. But this is enough for us to understand how reset mode works. So the width is either 3 or 3.5 microseconds, except at this point. Here it is 5 microseconds. So what happened here? If you have seen my PWM video, or previous timer videos, you would know that this is the point where the overflow occurs in the timer 2. When this happens, an update event gets triggered, and the counter of timer 3 resets at this point. Basically, here the counter of timer 3 overflowed, and then it started counting up. While doing so, another reset signal came, and the counter resets back to zero, and again starts counting up. If you measure the time from here, till the signal goes low, it will be approximately the same as the others. This 3.5 microseconds is the actual width of this PWM signal. We can calculate the similar thing at any other point, and it will give us the time equal to the width of the signal. So you saw how the reset mode is used to reset the counter of the slave timer. In this case, the trigger source was used as the ITR1, so the timer 2 was responsible for this reset. But you can also use some external signal to do this reset. We will see that in the upcoming videos. One more thing you noticed that when using the trigger mode, the APB clock was used as the timer clock. But if I switch it to the external clock mode, now the timer 2's frequency will be used as the clock for timer 3. Let's quickly see the output of this. Here you can see the frequency has been reduced significantly. This is because now 9 kHz is being used as the input clock, rather than 90 MHz in the reset mode. So I hope this video was able to explain the difference between the external clock mode and the reset mode. In the next video, we will use the external clock mode, and using that we will create a 48-bit counter, which will then measure frequencies with larger bandwidth. This is it for this video. The link to download the code is in the description. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching, and have a nice day ahead.